All right, let's try. My name is Hannes Willems. I'm doing the training for Miro. For a few years, we certified to do 4 different training courses at this stage. And lately, we've been inundated with a lot of demands for this TR069. And we realized that not a lot of people know actually what TR069 is. And Mikrotik were a little bit behind in implementing it on their systems. A lot of other CPEs already run on TR069. And so we decided to have a little bit of a look what TR069 specifically would be. As you can see, it's the CPE WAN Management Protocol, CWMP, TR069. And that makes you think immediately about SNMP, which is the Simple Management Network Protocol. And we will have a look at a little bit of a later stage. There's a lot of parallel lines between SNMP and CWMP, then, for that matter. All right. So what can this TR069 do? What's the specific job of TR069? What are we trying to achieve with TR069? TR069 enables remote and safe configuration of network devices called CPEs. It's configured from ACS, which is your cloud-based, most of the time cloud-based. I'm not aware at this stage of people doing their own based ACSs, but I do believe that will shortly be available also. CPE, as you all know, customer premises equipment, and that for TR069 don't need to be a Mikrotik. That can be any piece. We actually tested it with Grandstream telephones also, where it worked actually quite nice. The ACS is the auto configuration server, and that's the software that actually manages this whole run up. All right, so what must I do so that you can hear? That makes it difficult, then I can't see the screen. All right, so that's a little bit better. Right, as I said, the auto configuration server is the server where everything happens. That you will see if you compare it to something like the Dude or whatever, the auto configuration servers has got much more that I can do than the Dude. CPE, we already discussed that is on the receiving side, that's the piece of equipment you want to configure. All right, now what do I need then to do this? On my CPE device, I obviously need the URL where the ACS is going to sit. I'm going to need that period of time because it's not a permanent connection, it's a connection that only exists when you need it. So either or, I'm going to create events that's going to connect me to the ACS, or I'm going to have a periodic time period to make the connections. And then for security reasons, obviously, there will be usernames and passwords also involved. And as mentioned also, the communication, how does it happen, what does it do? The connection between the device and the ACS is not permanent. Most of the time, the CPE will activate via commands or via settings or via the time period that will connect to the ACS to do it. When we tested and play with it, we started doing the configuration on the Mikrotik. So what we did is we let the Mikrotik connect, and at that stage we upgraded the firmware automatically immediately when it connected, and we also just loaded a little bit of a script file to do something specifically. Right, this whole process, you get a session initialization from the CPE side. It will be authenticated from the ACS. The device will identify himself. The task execution, I'll show you now on the cloud device, will take place, and then the session will be closed. So it's purely connect when needed, do what we needed, and then there's no communication after that. There's a few of the commands that you actually can use. The ACS URL is saved or changed on a device, or the device is reset by factory settings, then you will get the bootstrap command coming in from the CPE device. The other times when it will connect is when there's a time visit, periodic. How do you pronounce that? That one. All right. And that's how we connect from the CPE side to the device. And then the ACEs can ask to connect to the device, but that's not the norm. So when there's something specifically happening and the ACEs must ask, the ACEs will ask, but the CPE must still initiate the contact. So you will never ever, for security reasons, you will never ever that the ACEs actually make physically connect. It's a request to connect, and that's where you get a connection request. And then if values change in the CPE, where you put physically alarms or whatever to it, you will get a value change command coming through, and that will also initiate contact. And then if a device is reset or reboot or whatever the case might be on this side, it will also, on a boot command, you can actually get the ACEs to respond back to the CPE. And then during one of the previous sessions, the ACEs order the device to initiate, and then you will get a scheduled, a physical scheduled connection. The device wants to report execution of previously ordered downloads and upload messages, and then we will have a transfer complete command that's running towards a MACLIC. And then if any of the previous commands have ordered something, we will have a diagnostic complete demand that's coming back. So I think in short, there's a few commands here, and I will compare that shortly with SNNP. SNNP has only got about two commands. It's, I think, set and get and those type of things. Where you can see this specific protocol have much more commands. And then lastly, the manufacturer of the device can actually put commands in himself also, where there's a specific need so that the device must make contact with the ACEs. Right. Why would we like to know about this? These reporting systems, whenever the device connects to you, that it can be reported. And one of the main reasons for that will be the second one, where you actually analyze the reasons. Let's say on too high temperature or on a too low throughput or whatever the case, alarm gets created. Contact is initiated from the device to the ACS. Rectifications get done and whatever. That's all automatically. You don't know about it. So there's reporting systems that will also help you to report back on those type of things. And you can set it. We'll see if you go into the ACE software itself. There's lots and lots of things that you can do. And then, as also explained before, the ACEs itself, can the ACEs make contact? No, it cannot make contact. It can only request contact. And then the CPE must agree, and then the CPE can make the contact for security reasons. How secure is TR 069? We use usernames and passwords. We can add certification to it. The norm for the communications would be HTTPS. You can go HTTP also, but it's normally HTTPS. And then we can also obviously modify the firewalls, and you can restrict your range of addresses that can connect to the ACEs. So is it secure? Yes, it's very secure. Once again, if you compare it to SNNP, the first versions of SNNP where there were no encryption and nothing available, not really designed for this job. And then just quickly the main benefits. It offers greater control over devices setting in comparison to managing them from configuration files. So I've got a central point where I can sit. Think about the bigger WISPs if you work with your Mechatics. Now you need a lesser qualified technician to physically go out to your premises. They hook up the device automatically go back to the ACS, and the ACS do the full configuration, and it's fully controllable. So you'll need maybe one or two technicians sitting at your ACS, controlling the ACS, making the decisions for you in the ACS, and you don't need a highly qualified technician on site all the time to go and set up your Mechatics. Obviously, that leads to shorter times for installing, and one of the very big benefits is it reduces the number of engineers that you need. We were trying to estimate during our trainings always how many spots or openings have you got in a graphic user interface of a Mechatics that you can fill in. We decided it's in the region of about 2,500. Anybody else want to make a suggestion on how many blank spots you've got in Mechatics that you can fill in? That's very, very intimidating for a new or a young engineer. You must go out to a site and he's got all these options. You eliminate that totally at the moment with this whole idea. Ah, and then there's a little bit of other advantages also. I don't think we need to go through that. I think the whole idea of what it's doing will give you all the advantages. And then let's have a little bit of a look. A lot of people have inquired, but what's the difference now between TR069 and SNNP? Can't we do the same with the two? No. SNNP were never designed as a specific protocol for configuring the devices. TR069 is a protocol designed for configuring devices. So you, just on your command system, if you have a look here, as I mentioned to you, there's only two commands I think that SNNP can get. It can have the get and set, and a little bit of traps. Where with the TR069, you've got various other commands that actually initiate and make contact. If you look at zero-touch provisioning, that's in the diagnostics and monitoring, data monitoring, all the types of things, SNNP were never designed for that. SNNP, as a matter of fact, was designed for alarms. So your device would go over temperature, your device would go offline, your device would have a throughput problem or whatever the case might be. And then SNNP would have received that as a third-party software between a lot of devices. It was never designed for specifically configuration of devices, where TR069 is designed for doing that. Then just a quick one, I think he had it on the slideshow also for Mikritik when he was telling about the new products. At the moment, there's four vendors that have actually tested and working with AV Systems, Friendly Technologies, and I wouldn't like to pronounce that one, and the Genie ACS. I've been in contact with all of them, and immediately on contact, they all sent me information back and they all were available for us and they started working with us. AV Systems joined us last week at the AFRICOM. They were down in South Africa showing a very keen interest to be involved in South Africa. So when we started playing with it, we just went to AV Systems for no specific reason or whatever the case might be, and we just experimented on the system at the moment. Pricing, all of them are very, very elusive when we start talking about pricing. So I unfortunately cannot give you an idea what it will cost to use the cloud servers at the moment, but I do believe that it will not be very lightly priced, because they've got a monopoly at the moment, at this stage right now. On the Mikritik itself, what do you need to do? Very, very easy. I think the speaker, the Mikritik guy, indicated that you must use a different package. So although the software is available, you must upload a package. It's not standard on your Mikritik. So you will not see it if you just open the software. You must download or initiate the TR069 software. As soon as you've done that, it's available. Sit just below the tool somewhere. And if you open up the screen, I can't see mice on mine. If you don't know if you can see on that side, all that you actually need is you need the URL that you must go to. You need the username, shutting, and you need the password. But that's now one of the other challenges we've got. You're a very big WISP supplier now, and you've got like 1,000 Mikritiks a month that must be installed. Now, you must grab hold of that Mikritik, and you must first program this into the Mikritik so that your technician can take it out and just install it on site. Fortunately, Mikritik lately came out with a very, very good way to resolve that problem also, and it's called FlashFig. If you go onto your net install software, you'll see they've got a new function there that's called FlashFig. Now, I'm not going to run through the whole setup. There's a very, very nice document available, Mikritik.com wiki manual FlashFig. I'll just give you some sort of idea what's happening here. You can, any new Mikritik, and I don't know from software version what, but the newer ones, all of them, if you start up and you've set up FlashFig on one of the Mikritiks, the other Mikritiks will physically connect to this guy via the switch, and within about 3 seconds, you will have a full configuration on your existing Mikritik. So what's going to happen is you're going to be in your head office where your technician sits that's also operating the ACE system. He's going to pull in Mikritiks, and if you've got a 48-port switch, good luck for you. You're going to have 48 Mikritiks. connected to the one MicroTik with the RCS files on it. You're going to switch on, and within about 3 seconds, you can switch off and take it out and put it back in the box. So to get those information onto the MicroTik, the startup information onto the MicroTik is a very, very easy exercise. MicroTik has done that for us. Right, so my presentation basically ends here. It was purely to get you involved on what TR069 is. I can, if I'm lucky enough, let's see if I make you can get connection to the site so that we can just have a very quick look on what's available. This is the AV system site, and as you can see, I've got a little MicroTik running in the background just somewhere where I'm online. We also tried. And how do I get there? All right, let me do this quickly. Yeah. I'll be with you in a few seconds. I can see it. That's a little bit better. Right, so at the moment, this is the cloud where I'm connected to. We had a little ground stream also in just for testing, and we've got the MicroTik. Yes, I mean, now the screen is totally distorted. Let's see. All right. You can, for instance, go and select devices and put them in groups. All right, let's try again. So what I can do is I can sort my MicroTiks by model number. I can sort my MicroTiks by MAC addresses. I can sort my MicroTiks, whatever the case might be, connect to the system, and then I can task it. So I can have different tasks that I can assign to something. And now via those 4 or 5 or 6 commands that I've explained to you a little bit earlier, depending on what the MicroTik would ask you to do, it will have a different task that will be executed whenever the MicroTik connect. So, unfortunately, this screen is now distorting a lot on my side. I haven't got a clue what I'm seeing here except the 3 dots. On the device management side, I can go in and select different devices. Build up groups for different devices. As I said, the options in this software is really unlimited of what you can do, and depending on what command you receive from your CPE, the ACS will execute that command and download. Software upgrades, as you say, monitoring, we can have graphs on this thing, you can do everything the dude can do, plus quite a bit of extra stuff. And gentlemen, I think that's basically conclusion of what I was trying to tell you. I hope I've sparked a new interest in TR069, and I hope you see the benefits of actually using TR069 compared to. We even had questions if you think about DHCP. A lot of guys said, but with DHCP, the different options, option 66 or whatever, can't you do basically the same job than this thing? By far not. Think about all the extra options you've got with TR069, specifically designed for configuration of devices. All right, gentlemen, questions? Should not, as I said, I hope I've planted a little seed here, and I hope you're going to do a lot of homework with me future wise. And let's see, Meneer. Yeah, definitely not a problem. This one is actually at the moment connected here in the background somewhere, and it's running through all the systems that's available to us. Yeah. That's part of the beauty of this system. It was specifically designed for that. So basically everything you can think of were taken into consideration to make your life easier. On the ground sim telephones, I promise you it's working quite well. Vox, yeah, some of the Vox guys involved, yeah. I think they are using it at the moment at your head office. I have phoned the guys and I've liaised a lot with them. That's why I quickly tried the ground stream also. Absolute no problem. Put it in, initiate with the URL, the username and password, and you switch it on. As soon as you switch it on, it did connection and it do whatever you task it to do. All right, gentlemen, I hope as I said, that I've planted a little seed here today. Go well. See you next time at the training. That's it.
Where's the other dongle that he had there?